good people are or how good architects are. We have chosen to give the lecture together. This is Renzo Vallebuona and myself. We sort of will change many times. We hope this way we can maybe have a discussion a little bit about the work. And I think it makes it easier if two people address you than one person. It's very difficult to discuss things nowadays, but it would be, in particular in this case, would be interesting to have your comments, and I hope it will be aggressive and productive for us to hear your comments. Am I speaking loud enough? I'm not sure.
No?
Okay, I'll try louder. The lecture is built up. We will show three projects. One is a project which was done, as was mentioned, in the office of late James Stirling and Michael Wilford in Berlin. The other two projects are projects which we did together shortly after, or one project in one case, actually while we were still working on this factory project, which you probably have seen in the magazines. We've also recently published a book on this factory, and we will try to show a little bit what we want to discuss in this book. This factory we will discuss at length in great detail. We'll show lots of sketches, detailed drawings, plans, diagrams, photographs on site, and so on, because we want to discuss what the what the proposals are. We want to discuss what, not so much how nice it is or how bad it is, but what the kind of method which we're going to talk about has produced, what kind of architecture has been produced by that. We think the interesting thing in this project is not so much how it looks, but how it was done, and also what it kind of means for the architectural world. The other two projects are unbuilt, and they will sort of relate, or they do relate in some case, well, probably in many cases, to this built project. And we'll sort of try to show that these thoughts can be expanded, can be elaborate, which have been started or worked out in this factory. Before we start with the slides, I would like to read a small part only of out of this book we've just published, because it kind of sums up somehow the attitude in, under which we think this project has been designed, and also to see, well, this is like a summary of the whole of our work so far. This what I'm reading is a translation, it's not by us, so it's kind of a bit funny, but I hope it's okay. There are two approaches to architectural design, virtually in opposition to each other. In the one case, the designer conceives a finished product, a building already predetermined. He has an image of a desired end condition towards he works, or towards which he works. This image can lend expression to an already held concept, or can arise from stylistic or philosophical considerations. In the second case, the approach to the design is based upon a conceptual grid derived from the task at hand. Its inherent potential is developed in stages. Here, the formal aim is initially uncertain and so plays only a subordinate role in the design process. In the first case, the architect can translate a specific image, a spatial quality, a formal arrangement, a metaphoric figure, or a stylistic intention immediately into built form. The autonomy of the individual part enjoys a privileged position with respect to the entirety. Achieving the desired effect is more important than being able to understand its creation. In the second case, the architecture develops from the logic inherent to the task at hand, as well as from the existing situation and the availability of materials. design decisions here are less the result of design facility than the sequential logical deductions. At the end of this process is a transparent structure, in quotes, transparent structure, which in all of its parts relates comprehensively to the entirety. It reflects the process of its derivation, best likened to one of discovery. The work process can be thus developed collectively so that the client and others involved in the planning process can play a more active role. The need to work within a prescribed formal repertoire is eliminated by this approach. A liberation from formal models as well as from, in quotes, antiquarian approach to history played a significant role in the design of these projects. Moreover, each architectural decision had to be comprehensible, not only to the architects collective that had worked on the project, but also to those on the outside, so that they could reconstruct the process that led to the building's specific nature. This kind of mental or intellectual process of reconstruction facilitates a self-explanatory and familiar and almost everyday attitude. As an example, the bearing structure forms the tectonic skeleton of the various buildings. It is derived from each specific architectural problem and is as such unique rather than typical. Where they are visible, the bearing elements offer the viewer simplified pictorial representations of the path taken by the physical forces. This tectonic element constitutes the building substance, as does in many cases the way in which the mechanical systems are conceived and integrated. Together, the two consolidate and lend precision to the architectonic functional structure inherent to the building. To facilitate the comprehensibility of the building's internal logic, solutions are sought which are clear and simple, not necessarily technically common. We will start with the slides. We'll first show the kind of like on a conceptual level this factory, then we will show three parts of that factory, and we'll mix it with some other work. And at the end we will show a little tour around the building very briefly. The material we're showing is partly, of course, drawings and things we produced ourselves, but also photographs by photographers who are sort of known for their kind of independent artistic abilities. As Gabriele Basilico in particular, an Italian photographer, has made many of the black and white photographs here. And also Giovanni Chiaramonte and a few others out of the office. Okay, so we start with the first slide. Oh, it works. Can we? This is just to show in what kind of framework we're going to discuss things. This is a very, very late 18th century mill building. It's just structure and nothing else. Similar thing in the sense Allard was building for a newspaper manufacturer. Just very simple structural solution. No kind of additions. It's just the pure structure. Or in Nervi, where the forces that are actually constituting the structure are shown in the ceiling. Or buildings like that. This is Le Castle, I think it's demolished, industrial building which just by its sheer expression shows what it's about. It's not more than that. It's not beautiful. And or a building like this, which is from the somewhere in Sweden, which is just a building which is very functional and set against a certain landscape background. This is Germany as we see it. a colorful mess. If I find the point. Oh, wow. What is that? What is it for? Ah, I see. Okay. Yeah, we go somewhere here. Doesn't really matter. Well, this is the first approach to the project. I first show a few pictures just to show you where we are, not actually explaining the project. We see, obviously, things in the landscape. It's quite a nice landscape. Something there, a building in that direction, and a few objects which are not really visible. We come closer. There are very large... Oh, sorry, that was a mistake. Back. A very, obviously, a very large-scale object, and things which are appear to be smaller. If one would be very close, one would see certain colors and certain relationships, materials, certain shapes in the landscape which seem to play a part in that landscape, which we will discuss. This is the area where the project is. This is Melsungen, this is this place. It's a small town, kind of medieval structure. Has been restored recently, or in the last 10, 20 years. It looks horrible, completely dead. All the black spots you see here are, most of them at least, are factories of the client we were working for. The client is a pharmaceutical company. It's not the ones that make these nice radios. Braun's name. They have been there for 200 years. They were a pharmacy originally and developed. As you can see, they put buildings up everywhere. At one stage, they decided, that was about 7, 8 years ago, they decided that they would need a completely new building for their medical plastic production. It's for, plastic production. And they choose a site very close to the town. The site is here, it's very large. This building is not, actually is the one that is not by that company. It's, as you can see, it's almost the size of the center of this town. The site is, as you could see in the first photograph, is actually in a very nice setting, forests, a valley, two rivers. We will see all that. These are the most important features in the landscape, which we thought important for our design. Oh, I'm doing the same mistake again. The features are, these kind of sharp edges are the forested hills, hilltops, which sort of very strongly define the kind of large-scale spaces. Obviously no forests in the valleys, this was a rural area, agricultural. Large elements like railways, roads, rivers, which define the main kind of main artificial elements. If you would call them that way, viaducts. This, for example, is a viaduct cutting through the valley. Roads, obviously, you see here, this point becomes very important for us. This is in the valley, like a traffic island. This is a slightly higher piece, which then became one of the elements important to our design. These are kind of sort of sketches showing the basics of the idea. This is now turned 90 degrees. So what was below is now up. The main idea being that the site should be divided into two halves, one relating more to the landscape and one sort of being more internal, industrial. The as you can see here already, this kind of little hill place, a certain important point. We thought the project or the main disposition of these buildings should be through elements which are not like buildings. Because it's a very large site, it's about 800 meters, maybe 450, 500 meters. It should not be like sort of big buildings with kind of many, many windows, but it should be divided by or ordered, organized by elements which are of very large scale, but don't have really the scale of a building. So one of these ordering things is this. This is a horizontal element and a vertical element. This was the site before we started, quite nice. And I'm not sure it really has improved. But this is this little hill, and this is our site. at this, when the photograph was taken, there was no railway bridge in this valley, which you will probably see later, which has kind of spoiled a little bit the visual purity of this area. It's one of the, it's this German railway that goes north-south, these very high-speed trains, which they built many, many very bad bridges, which ruin the landscape completely. This is sort of what we're trying to do somehow in that space. We're sort of trying to make it an area where something happens, some tension, if you want to call it. These are diagrams showing the basic elements. Sorry, go back. I'll learn it eventually. You see the main features of the valley again. One river is missing here, actually. There's one river, this river Fulda, and another river, a small river here. They meet in this at this point. This is this traffic island. One building running along the direction of one valley and the other perpendicular. The one in a long direction was like the back, like a, not a backbone, but sort of like something, like a, something the whole project leans against. This very thin vertical line is meant to be this division between front and back. And there's something else, a third element, which was added later, which is something at very large scale also, which relates to the shape of the landscape. There are also smaller things, relationships to other parts, which we will discuss. This is actually the wrong way around, but this is very small buildings. I will discuss the functions in more detail, but this is kind of small buildings which subdivide the, I have to go one further, which subdivide the scheme which is made out of these very large elements into very small zones, which are sort of like urban, almost urban conditions where buildings meet. This is the scheme in its final diagrammatic form. The main elements, the horizontal along the valley direction, vertical, and some other element, we will go through that. And small buildings which sort of play a certain role in sort of marking certain areas, dividing areas. That was a model, not a very early stage, but sort of somewhere in between, which shows the whole project in a complete form. We'll see that later also. The main functions, the company wanted production, pharmaceutical production, which was this, is this element. They also needed a huge storage system for their German, or I think probably for the European market. They also wanted some administration and a couple of supporting things like energy center. They wanted a canteen, they wanted little administration buildings, a fire station, gatehouses, and so on. One of the first decisions in the project was one regarding traffic and organization on the site, being that we decided already in a very early stage that cars should be in a multi-story car park. They wanted 1,500 cars on this site, and we thought 1,500 cars would actually represent an area like this as a car park. This was not acceptable to that particular situation. So we convinced the client that a multi-story car park would be the right solution. So we split very early, we split the traffic into small car traffic, what's it called, sort of individual traffic in the front and lorries in the back. I have not mentioned that this project was done as a competition, and we were invited with, I think, 8 or 9 other architects. And what we show here is already a development of this competition project. But this idea of a car park was already in the competition. It was a great risk for us, but the client kind of liked it. Also, our project obviously was more expensive than the competitors. On the kind of sort of circulation level, this project, as I said, is very large. This is 550 meters, 350 maybe. On the circulation level, we decided that the project should be linked by a pedestrian system, which is these black arrows, so that all main parts of the buildings are linked by a system of pedestrian routes, which are in fact all bridges, basically. Bridges, because we have a situation in the valley. Here is, it's higher here, it's lower, and then it's high again here. So we were actually able to make a bridge system which crosses, goes from here to there, and ends on natural level, on ground level here, and on ground level there. So it's like a natural way of connecting the various sides of the valley. Another basic decision was to link production and storages by a similar system of bridges. This is just shown here. The vertical points mean that there's a kind of vertical connections. We'll talk about that later. And this is of a ring shaped kind of circulation system just for goods, just for transport of goods. This was a very early stage, a matrix showing the development of the project. One of the main difficulties with the design of that scale for the industry is that you have to, you don't know how the building is going to develop. You don't know the first stage is maybe is defined a certain size, and the second stage may be different. It might develop one part of the building, like the production building might develop faster than the storage. And there are many, many factors which you cannot control. So our decision was to sort of define guidelines somehow along which those buildings can develop. The guidelines you actually saw before, these are the main elements basically which are then form kind of constitute the main elements in landscape. This, for example, is just the kind of development of the production, development of certain links, and the development of storage. The idea was that the building would never have, or we knew that the building would never have a definitive kind of final shape, so it cannot be controlled in a kind of architectural sense that you have a certain proportion of a building, and then if you add something, you can control that proportion and so on. So it was something that could grow at a kind of wild rhythm which you could not control. So this posed one of the biggest problems, in fact. This is the first stage, and as you can see, I mean, the first stage is completely random, kind of, it's a very small production building, a piece here, a piece there, a very big piece here, a little piece there, car park, and so on. What we decided, and the client was kind of good enough to accept it, is that we define the main elements, like this thing in the valley. We define this ring, or part of this ring. We define a kind of an area where this building can develop. We define a sort of zone where this building can develop, and those buildings also. But we would sort of already in the first stage be able to control the perimeter somehow a little bit, and so that the buildings would later then not be spoiled by any developments which are uncontrollable. So and now we show the first building of the three, which is the administration building, and this is Renzo is going to show the first building. This is one of the three kind of constituting elements in the landscape.
So we're going to show just a couple of these fragments of these buildings of the project. We're not going to show the whole project. The first one is going to be the administration building, this small building here, which is the only one of the whole project, which is, as you see here, which is sort of orientated towards the outside of the project. And it's orientated towards this small hill in the middle of the valley. So we're going to try to make plausible the location and the shape and what happens around this building. So when you enter the valley, the first thing you see in the middle of the valley is this small object there on the back. That's the administration building. And as you come closer to it, you sort of run towards the building and come closer. It's not sharp enough. And closer, so that at some point you almost look under the building and then pass the building, and you see on the back of the building is the factory, which you couldn't see before. So here is the last picture of the sequence. So that the building standing here, this is administration, and this is a hill, is in a very important position in terms of large landscape relationships between this part or this park as well, which is an Acadian part of the whole project, and all this green area which goes through here. So the building actually should link this front with this, let's say, back of the project, instead of dividing these two. Here you see it a little bit better. The road would run somewhere here, and you see you sort of look under the building, you look through the building, and on the back is the rest of the factory. And you see the building is very monolithical, is very anonymous building, very abstract as possible, and doesn't cut this topographical profile here. So here is probably easier to see. The one side, let's say the front of the building, which is orientated outwards, is this large-scale monolithical part, which is very unitarian, and is here's a hill. And on the back of this building, there are these other elements, which are circulation system. This is elevators, tower, and this. The stairs, and there is another part of this, let's say, complex, which is this building at the bottom, which is that one, which is anchored to this geometry, to the geometry of the project. This is the front side, this abstract part with this part underneath, the bearing structure on the office block. And this is the back with this sort of smaller or architectural scale elements, which are, as you see, perpendicular but orientated according to the system of the whole factory. This is just a view, sorry, it's a sketch of the back of the building with all these small scale elements. And this would be the office. So the structure of the building, in fact, reflects what happens with the building in the landscape. I mean, we see these, let's say, cones which penetrate into the building and somehow order the whole building in section, and this would be in the, let's say, length section. So, on one side, the building gives this place around the hill a new, let's say, identity, On the other side, the building uses the situation on the hill to be what it is, to work like a bridge. And in fact, I want to show you in just a couple of sketches as the structure, how the structure really works. You see here the edges. The building is actually fixed in the middle. The column which is in the middle is fixed, and the building moves that way from the middle and that way according to temperature difference. So the columns are not like this one, which would be as a mushroom column, which would move on the top and being fixed here. But it's actually like that. It's anchored to the body, to the truss of the whole office building on the top. And as you see here, it moves horizontally here. So the transfer point here is sometimes there, sometimes there. And if it's close to the middle of the building, it moves just a little bit. But if it is the last one, it moves a lot. So it works really like, let's say, like a normal bridge. And in fact, by being so, these cones couldn't stay alone before being linked to the whole truss of the building on the top. So you see, this is just a link element, and here would be the transfer point. This is a very early section, but it shows the tectonical order of the building, the intention of making a building which responds to this role in the landscape, to the natural context, and which sort of integrates every single part of the building inside into this task of being as a whole, which responds to this other task. And in fact, all the loads you see here, they go down here and they go into the cone, and the cone is actually like a shell. It's not as thick as here. It's like a shell and brings all the loads to this point. And from one cone to the next, on the top of every cone there is this structure which goes here to the top and every floor. And from one cone to the next there is this element here, which we're going to show later a little bit more in detail. Here are these sketches just to explain a certain point. We were tempted to break the scale of this cone-shaped column and to make out of it something which has absolutely no scale, something like here. Well, it's sort of, it's not nice, but it's very, it's a strange object. It's something like these works by Klaes Onderburg, which are sort of over-dimensioned, like, I don't know, like this floating Swiss knife in Venice, or enormous billiard balls in a park in Münster, whatever. And this is a class I was showing you. From one here on the bottom would be one cone, and there the next, and so on. So the whole structure is just these elements you see, and they're all prefabricated, and they're all small elements. That was the decision of making the cone, not painting it like that, but making the cone just part of this whole structure by having the same, sort of speaking the same language as these other elements of the building. So that the whole appears as just one thing in which this shows sort of this more dramatic moment of the whole structure. And in fact, the entrance to this building, the access level, is, as Walter said, is a sort of bridge level. It's 5 meters, more or less 5 meters below, above ground. So one would enter here between this building, which is the one on the bottom, where is the computer facilities, and the one at the top here, which is the offices. Here we see it very clearly. And this is the, on this level is the entrance level, and this is the transparency of this building. So here we go to the right and find ourselves below the offices and on the top of the computer facilities. And at this level, we are still not in the building, but we are still below. So this is the entrance hall, which is just a roof hanged under this building. As you will see, there is still this cones. And as you see on the pavement, it's just like an external space, and this is not really an entrance hall, but it's just a protected shelter space. So here it's probably better to see the, all these difference and different elements. So on one side we see, again, from here, from the entrance, the situation on the hill on one side, and looking to the back, the factory. So that this building, as a bridge, links these two different parts of the project on these two different scales. And over the roof, which is hung here, we see already the building, the office track where we want to go. So we just enter the one of these towers, in this case with the stairs, and go upstairs. And from upstairs, from if we look outside, we see the factory again. So that the orientation and the location of the building becomes plausible. And then when we enter the building, we, this is the finished building, we see again all these elements I show you in building site. So the whole rhythm and the distances within the building are regulated by the structure which was seen already on the entrance hall. And this is just a detail which is related to the facade. The facade on the outside has a certain rhythm, that one. And on the inside, it's just, it's like a ribbon. I mean, it's just a continuous window. So that in case of having two people working in one office, they will use this space. And if there are three, they will use that space without doubling the, without taking another fenestration bay completely. So there's more freedom in the divisions within the building. And, well, this is from the outside, where you have, well, this very normal 1-to-1-to-1. And, oh, sorry. Okay. And the inside we have the fenestration base are, because of this triangular element, we have a continuous element which is sometimes divided here and sometimes can be divided here. And within these triangular elements which go all along the facade, you see there is some small hole. There is the inlet for ventilation. There is, to avoid mechanical systems which are very complicated, we just develop, actually it's not a new thing, it's a very old system. On the bottom of the building, this air coming in and goes up through these triangular elements and will flow into the offices through these holes, which you find in every one of these triangular elements. And this air is taken out here on the top and goes into this triangular truss in the middle, the triangular beam in the middle of the building and the corridor. And from there goes to the ends of the building where a very small normal ventilator sort of keeps this air circulating the whole time with no noise and no air conditioning system or anything like that. So that the windows here are very normal wooden windows which you can open and close as you like. It doesn't have any impact on this system. Here you see it a little bit better. On the behind these elements here, there's a hole which connects this space here with this beam, with the whole part of the beam, so that at the end of this beam there's a ventilator. And as you see here, this element is just one continuous window. And in fact, the divisions, they come just to this point, so that this from here to there is just a glass pane in the whole height, so that you standing in your office can look through all the building theoretically. This is just for the windows on the back, which are as high as the floors, and which are different again. There are elements which are here, sort of these triangular elements are within the. This is the inside of the building. This is the wall. And they're like holes, so that the scale of the building doesn't change, it remains just as a hole. And here on one side is a window, a normal window, which is that one. And on the other side is some, how you call that, opaque glass, so that just light comes in. So that in case you have an office here, from one side, well, you can look out, look into the valley, and from the other side, you would have light coming in. So this is the view, so that the view is controlled, like the view on the other side. And a very similar system we applied in the. This is the computer room, the main computer room, and it's very, as you see, very abstract. It's all technology, and this wall which is here looks very sort of not vertical. It is actually not. It's show you. It's like that, so that the whole structure makes these divisions of the space and give the rhythm, and they are used as well for these technical systems, as you see here, so that air would come in here, from here would come in here, and would be taken out from the top, would go down that way. So that, in this case, the same, the whole structure of the building is already used from the very beginning to articulate the spaces within the building and to respond to the role of this building in the landscape, in this case, a very abstract, the abstract shapes. So, we go. This is just a facade, which is very simple. It's just metal cladding, which is single metal sheets which have been bent here to sort of see the thickness of the material. And as you see these tiny little holes, they're just sort of has been, every sheet has been cut in the way that a piece of the metal, of the same metal, has been just bended backwards and used as a hook, which has been just hung into vertical running channels. So this is a very, very simple system. In fact, if you stand very, very close here and you look upwards, you would see more or less the whole structure and the thickness of these metal elements. Now we go to the next.
This Ice Age man doesn't mean anything, actually. it's an occupier, he occupies space, so that's what I mean. As you have heard, we are very interested in these kind of structural systems. We're also interested in that everything in the building, everything you see is actually understandable why it's there, that the metal cladding is a metal cladding, is a cladding which is added to a building, so it has no kind of tectonic function except being a cladding, like a coat you wear, but it's not actually the building. And that you also saw that the structures play not only a kind of a constituting part of the shape of the building, but they also are part of the mechanical systems. In this case, this is a partisan built project, this is in Berlin. In this case, the structure was developed, or the kind of the whole building, the whole type of building was developed from a very special urban situation, in contrast to the situation we saw on the landscape. It's also an administration building. This is Kochstrasse, one of these grid areas in Berlin. That's Checkpoint Charlie here. In the 60s, they built a very low, I think it's a three-story building, plus a tower. And this scheme was meant to be destroying the block, if you want, putting something on a platform, the tower on a almost like a square, on a plaza, probably call that, and then this low building as a sort of freestanding object almost on this platform. The job was, or that was a competition, invited competition. Our project was to make an extension to this tower. You may actually have seen this project because I think Matthias Sauerbruch, who was here many times or is still here, I don't know, has actually worked in the same competition. He's actually won it. So we had to expand this building. The problem was that there is a sort of like a 60s ideology. This is this kind of low building and a high building. It both together sort of makes sense architecturally. If you start increasing density, say put a block around this tower, it would probably destroy its quality. So we were concerned about finding some sort of shape or some positioning of these additions which would actually allow that tower to remain as a tower, remain visible, and kind of remain a kind of a reasonable architectural object. The tower is a very low architectural quality. Only qualities it has was that it's actually an object in space. I mean, it has no kind of no nice facade or anything like that. this model shows more or less the scheme. We said that the tower should remain freely freestanding, and we would leave the corners of the site open, in this case three corners. This is the Kochstraße, this is the, like the main road, so that one could see when you walk past here, you could actually see the tower from, you have this corner view of the tower, which is probably the only quality this building has, is that you see kind of a vertical object in the space. And whatever is left, if you make this kind of arrangement, then forms the new building. So the buildings are like negative pieces, if you want. And that constitutes this kind of funny shape of these buildings, funny triangle. It's a bit like, I mean, it's sort of slightly far-fetched, but maybe, if you probably know these things by Doxiadis, it's a way of kind of positioning a building in a space when you look from a corner, like this, as you know, the Parthenon here, I think it's probably Parthenon, appears at the same angle from this point, so it appears as a very important building. It's a bit like placing a tower in a situation like this. It's a bit far-fetched, I know, but it's kind of, it's one thing you're certainly familiar with, and that's just a view out of the same book. This is a charcoal drawing. This is that tower, pretty ugly, and these are the buildings that sort of frame a view to that tower. Maybe a new tray or something like that. So we were faced with this problem of these triangular buildings. And we thought that one could not make a triangular building by just cutting a rectangular building in half, but that a building should actually develop out of this triangular situation. Yeah, right. Thank you. So we developed the structure. These three triangles, just to add that, are all different. I mean, they're not regular in any way. They're kind of all different. So we thought of a way, we were looking for a structure that could actually constitute a kind of a structure which supports this triangular idea. So we subdivided the triangle into five equal, in terms of the area, not in the geometrical sense, equal triangles, and put a circular element in the center, in the gravity center, more or less, of this triangle. And this would constitute the structure. This is a bit like the cones, if you want, of this other building, but actually, in this case, it's like a tube. And the tube has a cantilever. This is this dotted thing here, which then supports the surrounding part of the ceiling. As you can see, these towers were then also used as circulation elements. They contain lift staircases, and they also contain ventilation for the office spaces. They also are like architecturally or spatially, they are sort of like the initial elements, which then form elements of part of a corridor system, which kind of then subdivides those spaces. This is just one, any of these plans. I don't know. As you can see, we also developed a kind of flexible system. The space is really this, and then you add whatever you need to make it function. In the section, see these cores. We're also very concerned about. Everything that you see should actually be sort of real. So we didn't want to have basements in this case, but that you actually see when you walk past this building, you will see the foundation. You will see that in one of the buildings in the factory, in fact, that the foundation is also visible, so that you know how the building stands on the ground. This is the structural system developed by engineers Fink and Poloni in Berlin. Same engineers that I've worked in the factory. As you can see, they've kind of simplified or the position was in a way a result of the structural kind of logic of this triangle. This is just one example of one of the triangles. And this is sort of a view inside. You just see the cores, no partitions. This thing here, this represents the structural piece you need to actually cantilever and support the slab.
I think we see that here, yes, that's part. The more detailed section of the same. And the services, or like the ventilation, was very similar to this building in the landscape, so that air is actually sucked out of the office spaces through these vertical elements and out into the air and comes in through zones in the perimeter. This is in more detail here, just as a sort of idea. And this is the building, one view of the building. Another one at night, where you can actually see these supporting elements. That's all that constitutes the architecture of this building. Everything else is sort of left to almost the minimal you need for a building. You need a balustrade for legal reasons or whatever. And you virtually have no window divisions or anything. It's just that the actual core of the building, the substance of the building, constitutes its visual appearance. Then you see the model. Becomes very clear that this is the space we saw, the perspective, and then the three elements. Another model view from the back. As you can see, the tower is left free so that one could see the whole building. And from the front, this would be Kochstrasse. This is sort of like the most important road. You pass here and you see these, you have these views into this building. So now we go back, this is another Stone Age drawing, which has no meaning, and we go to the factory again, and Renzo.
Here we are, we have the same problem of a building which has been added to another one, as the one shown by Walter. So this building, I want to explain first is this, the longer one here, and the other one is in fact that one, and we call it circulation wall. It's the longest element of this project, and it was the first built here. It was the element which sort of defined the geometry of the position, a location and in geographical scale of the whole project. The dimension of this is something like 250 meters, and it's rather high. Well, we're going to see that now. So to realize a little bit the scale of this building. We wanted to oppose to this curve here of the valley. This just follows the natural curve of the valley. We wanted to oppose the horizontality of this, I call it building, which is just is that long and very, very narrow. So it's really just like a wall, a circulation wall. And here is probably easy to understand what happens there. So one of the first problems of this building was the scale of it, because it's that it's so enormously it's so huge that there was we tried to find a way. We tried to find a way to modulate the surface of the building so that it doesn't really look like a building, but it goes back to a more sort of primitive element, something which seems to belong to the natural context. So, well, when we've been playing with sand a couple of weeks, trying to develop a structure for the surface of the building, which could, of this concrete building, which could help to solve this problem, as we've seen that in, well, sort of, I've investigated that in very small scale and one-to-one, and trying to understand what happens with the light and with the rain and how this building could behave in a natural context afterwards. So we came to this surface. This is from the finished project. As you see, this absolutely seamless is because they are somewhere there, sort of very, very homogeneous monolithical element. So, and it's very, because of the roughness, so the surface doesn't really look like a normal building, which I forgot to say, the orientation of this building is exactly north-south, so that the sun suddenly comes here from the other side and comes over here, and this building, the whole surface, would be lighted. So by having this surface with shadow and these other parts which are in the light, it becomes more natural. It doesn't become white like that on the top, but becomes gray and then light gray and lighter, and then in the evening begins to sort of fade down again, depending on the light. And the same building, we thought, because of this quality of the surface, which gives this morphologically very primitive surface, and this massiveness has this. This is a gap between two parts of this building, so that it actually would rain inside, so that this becomes greenly, as the same as in the outside, is going to be dirty and become green and sort of age in a different way, not like a building, but like an enormous monolithical element, which could be more part of the natural environment. And this horizontal line here it shows the circulation level. So inside this building is lots of stairs. I'm going to show you a section, and the main landing of these stairs is on this point where you come out and go into the timber bridge, which is on the front of this building. And these divisions are they are the landings, they are there, but they are sort of to modulate the whole element so that it's not just one non-scale monolithical thing, but it's an articulated enormous element. And this is the sort of the second building which has been added to that one, and we had the very difficult task to add a building in front of this which should stand on the park, but which shouldn't become, as you see here in these drawings, shouldn't become part of this building, of the red one, but should somehow maintain its own identity. It should, I think the sketch shows it's a very ugly one, but it shows very well the intention of making a building which is in very high degree able to define itself as it is. So it's a very different building from the back, from the one on the back. So that we try to create this tension between these two buildings without leaving that one on the back or putting this just on the front of the other one, so that both have their own a clear identity. And These are just other views of this building, where the timber structure goes at the angles down there again. These elements, these columns on the front, they just fall all the same parallel. They are one unitarian element. And the ones on the back, those ones, I show you in the section now, they flatten towards the end so that they always have a different angle. They open like a fan, and then they close towards the middle, and then they open again, so that they react to the topography, more or less what we explained here and what we're going to explain later here. One part of the building is this one, it just runs parallel and defines the whole unity, and the other part reacts to every single point here by the inclining. So at the end it's very flat and almost lean. This column lean towards the wall, and in the middle they become almost vertical. And this is a section through this circulation wall where you see there is just stairs linking all these different levels of the park of the car storage on the back. So wherever you park on the back, you go upstairs or downstairs, you come to this level where you sort of cross this element and come to the garden side where you run, you can walk along here, and you see this facade, so to say, the corridor, the thickness here in the middle is different from the ends. So I'm going to show that later as well. And this shows the reaction of these columns according to the situation, to the topographical situation. So this is towards the ends, where you from this corridor go into the circulation wall, and towards the middle separators more and more. This is well, it's probably rather difficult to understand. This is the plan of the bridge, which becomes very, very narrow in the middle because of this changing of the angle of these columns, becomes very, very narrow, and then becomes wide again till they allow you to go into the circulation wall. And here it's probably easier to understand the situation then. And here you see again all these columns in one unitarian order, and those change, becoming more and more vertical, you see, towards the middle. They're almost vertical, and then they flatten again to the back. So this is one of these. It's sort of a small section through this building. So this is a column which goes and runs parallel to the building, and this is the one which is inclined to the back towards the circulation wall. And if you try to imagine this column falling that way, falling over that way, and the other one falling over the other way, almost perpendicular to this, and you somehow manage to link them with a very stiff element. This is a pure theory at the beginning. I can show you that with my fingers. You know, I may have a little bit light. Thank you. Sorry for the Italian way of explaining. It's very simple. I mean, is this follows that way, and the other one will follow that way, and you manage to hold them. They would try. They wouldn't fall over. They would try to twist. And so if you still hold them very, very stiff, they would just stay, and the whole twist effort would go, in this case, by having the corridor on the top, which stiffens the whole structure, the loads go to the next couple of columns, which try to follow as well, and they fall over the other way round, so that they sum up, and they do not fall. They do not fall over, but they just work if the whole building is finished. In fact, it was scaffold till the very last column was put. And this very dynamical system shows how this building here can't stay alone without this one, because all these loads sort of add. And after, I think, 9 of these columns, the whole loads go through this, transfer into the circulation wall at exactly the same point where on the top you go, you cross from this wall into the bridge, as you see there, so that the this division of the circulation wall responds to this as well, and this building responds to that, so that every element of this building actually is just part of a very complex synergetical system, a construction which is not allowed to, which is not able to stay alone, but stays dependent from this at a very, very precise distance. So this just shows the corridor on the top, which is hung within the main structure. And in the middle is very, very narrow, and you have a very high, what do you call this element? Balustrade. And from the end you have this perspective because of the geometry of the building. Then the roof, the ceiling in this case, is horizontal, but it goes down, as you see here, the balustrade is minimal, and in the middle we're seeing that it's more than 1 meter. So entering the building, you have a strange perspective, and walking through, you have it again, so that towards the middle seems rather long building, but when you're standing here, as you more or less see here, the second half looks very, very short, but it's actually not, it's exactly the same. As you see, well, at the end of the bridge, before you go into the circulation wall, the balustrade doesn't really exist anymore, and at that point you're very, very close to the ground again, so that the situation of this building becomes very clear, and then you leave it and go into the circulation wall. So that's the next building.
This is the last of the three elements of this project, which I'm not going to show all the other parts because it's would go on forever. This is the part of the production building which was actually constructed. The production building, as you saw in these long sections, is opposing. This was the first building we saw. This is what you just saw here, and this is here. it's running in the long direction of the valley and has the kind of architectural role of being the, like the backbone of the whole scheme. One of the early decisions in the design was to try to move up the people who actually work in this factory, in this production building, most of the people work there, to move them as high as we can into the space, into the valley, so that they have a kind of more attractive situation to work in. As you can imagine, if you are in that sort of valley, you don't really want to work on the ground next to a lorry or something, but you actually want to be in the space. So the whole building was built up as a kind of built up towards this kind of main thing of having those people work as high up in space as possible. This level is actually the level of the bridge. So the building was developed very early, before we actually knew exactly how the production works in this factory. We thought maybe one could use the shape of the site, one could use it to layer things vertically. So as we've shown, there's a sort of circulation level for pedestrian, there's a level of goods movement. And so we thought if one separates all these layers, one could actually have a building where the actual production level, which is the most important, is supported by things underneath. So that logically, of course, then it would mean that those things would not disturb the production space and would allow a very big space without any interruptions of vertical elements. This is the street level. Oh, sorry, go back. Want to have the point? Just showing that on the street level there in this production building, there's very little. It's the wrong slide. Sorry, it's actually pedestrian level. On street level, there's nothing but ducts. There's no rooms where people work. On this bridge level, which is the level you see here, here's the whole circulation system of the factory. This is the entrance hall, the bridge, and then connections to other parts, storages. On this level, you end on the ground floor, on the ground again. There are technical rooms and there are changing rooms. The production is a clear environment production, which means that people have to change clothes before they can go in. It's like a sort of computer production. It's quite similar. It's not as drastic, but it's sort of similar kind of technology. Next level up, this is the goods transport level connecting to the storage. On this level, we find also kind of supporting functions like little offices and packing, unpacking areas for the production. And the actual... Oh, we've lost the slide. Anyway, on the actual production level, as you can see, there is nothing that interrupts that big space. The building is about 30 meters deep and in the end will be 550 meters long. Street level, as I said, nothing but just ducts and kind of, it's basically keeping its territory. Again, this kind of idea of the building is not actually destroying the landscape, but sort of sitting on top of the landscape. This is a technical level. All the plant rooms are here. This is the bridge level connecting to the little rooms, changing rooms, double height. Then there's a sort of goods transport level, and then the actual production. On top, there's a huge roof area for technical services. Out of this kind of special landscape situation, we developed the idea of having the plant on the bottom, having ducts which then become columns that take air up to the roof, and from there the air is, in fact, that was in the later development, is kind of treated again and then used to actually supply this big production space. Here's the slide that I was hoping to have before. As you can see, this is a production level. It has a kind of funny rhythm of not perpendicular kind of lines. This is the projection of the roof structure. You can also see already that there's obviously big elements in the front and rather small, relatively smaller elements on the back. We'll discuss that. So this idea of working high on a platform in a landscape, uninterrupted by any kind of columns, by sort of ducts staircases and so, developed into this sort of structure. You have big columns below, a platform, and something on top. This sketch shows that. This is the building under construction. You see this level of the wall continuing to become the production level, and you see this kind of fairly kind of filigree kind of net of roof structure. As it's very clear that here the building is divided into two parts. One, the lower part, very, very large. This is about 10 meters, this is 12 meters, and then something quite different on top. It looks a bit like maybe a railway bridge, and we think it's not really like a building. Another view under construction, and we're going to go through this. When we fly over it, you actually see how the structure works. And this is from the back. This is not, it's out of focus, maybe it's the side. In the back you see the very small columns, and four of the small columns actually make three columns in the front, mediated by this kind of very large scale structure, which is 30 meters. This kind of structure has the effect of this very long building actually becoming in a long direction, also becoming like one piece. It becomes a kind of structurally kind of rigid element, instead of just being something you add one piece to the next. One, you could just make an arch in another one. You actually have a net which makes a very stiff element. This is almost impossible to terminate, that system, so it had to go through firewalls and everything. This is the same section, just under construction. As you can see, big columns, small in the back because of the shape of the landscape, and this production level and the big arches. This is also something I said in the beginning, that we wanted to show structures, how they work, and this is sort of saying we support that and we stiffen this building. So when you walk through here, you're always aware of this kind of structural grid or structural rhythm. This is under construction. These huge these huge elements, which are ducts and also columns, as you could see in this photograph under construction, have played this role in the landscape of something very, very large, a bit like this big wall. And we didn't want those columns to be subdivided by stage. As you probably know from, if you build in concrete, you can't pour concrete 12 meters in one piece. It's very difficult vertically. So we lay the columns horizontally, poured them, and then they were erected. So that the column is like one big piece and is not subdivided by any kind of small scale division. That's a very important element to us, that elements that belong to the substance of the building should not be compromised by any kind of building technology, which is sort of not really appropriate. You see the big columns in front from the back, and then the small columns in the back from the front. And that's how it looked before the building was actually put together. And you see how large these things are. One should also be aware of them. Of course, as an architect, you walk around this building and or this site, and then you look at these huge columns and so. But it's actually something you never see, because you always walk in these kind of pedestrian systems, 5 meters above ground or higher. So you're not really aware of the scale of that. This is what you see when you pass with a lorry or a car. So it's not really. I don't think one would do that in a kind of an inner urban condition. This is how the building looks. And complete, you see these kind of massive elements, which are actually ducts. And you can also see how these ducts, this is metal, and you see how the duct comes out of the column and disappears in the roof. This long thing here is a visitor's gallery, which was a wish by the client, so that he could show how his production works. I will show that in a minute. This is how it relates to the landscape. This is from the gate, more or less. Just to mention that these things are not facades in a sense. In fact, we have never designed any facades. We've never drawn any facade drawings. We just say the building develops from its inner logic, and then we see what happens. This is just a kind of temporary facade, which when the building will be expanded, will just move forward. So there's no kind of design in that, as far as we see it. This is a view from the production level. You see out into the landscape. it's a bit clearer here. Do you see the production level? And this is the level of this visitors gallery I mentioned. The idea was that the people who work here can look out into the landscape without being compromised by the people who look into the production above. It has a sort of negative effect, nota bene, that people don't really like that when visitors look down into this production space. And I don't think we would do it again. We would certainly avoid it. This is a model of that point where the column stops and the air duct comes out. And as you can see, everything is visible. I mean, the whole you can actually understand the whole building by just without knowing. All I'm talking now is really just because you're not there. I mean, if you go there, it's very clear. This is the reality. Then you see these ducts. And this is this it's not in focus. Can I focus that? This is this uninterrupted huge production space. That was the aim, of course, flexibility and all that, so that they could do whatever they liked in their space without being compromised by architecture. This is the main access road in the center of the building where people who work there come in. They change clothes here, they step over this bench, change shoes, change clothes, and then go up to that level, and then they change clothes again, I think from gray to white coats, and then they go up above there is the production. And these are these kind of elements which show this is structure of primary, of a kind of a main. This structure has a different scale than the building, so it's like landscape scale. This is on the other side of the level, in the same level we were just on the landscape side. You can see a very small scale. People actually have a direct relationship to the garden, which is at that stage wasn't complete. Now it's green, so that one could see directly out and also could go out if possible. This is a restroom. There are a couple of those things which are very small scale. People can go there for small pauses and eat their sandwich or whatever. You see that thing in the context. This is one of these provisional elevations. Again, there's no architecture in there. You also see one building here. This is one of the plant. This is the main plant energy center. It's called the first stage ends here, and then later will be added. You also see some of the links. This is the link, the goods transport. This is a pedestrian level, and the kind of small scale in the back. And again, this is a view you don't really have because they never approach the building like that, but sort of, as you can also see, the building doesn't really touch the ground. And then we come to another project. And then we...
Some of the other...
Then one project, then...
Well, don't worry, this is the last one. Just want to show very shortly the case, which is analogous to the last one, in which a building more or less has been born from the context. It's the building here, so it's outside Frankfurt, which is here, is one of these horrible cities, this administration or administrative cities outside Frankfurt. The reality is really not any better. And one bank, which owns already this building, has bought a couple of them here around, so they have decided to expand. And then we had for the first time a problem of having to deal with this agglomeration of buildings which are just objects, and each one of them is normally one institution. And now we have some of them which are sort of part of the context, and some new buildings we have to build. And we try to create a system to integrate all these other, in this case these yellow ones, and the black ones. The black ones are the of this new institution, to integrate them in one single system. So the old sort of political or economical divisions of the site had been avoided by using elements which are natural elements or architectural elements which are of larger scale than the single sites. So in this case, this is this very large building. all the elements which have been added respond to a logic which is part of the whole area here, so that we can have a large scale area to cope with the situation here as a rural situation and with this other agglomeration of blocks. So this is this element again, and that's more or less it's just a sketch for the logical principle. So here is probably easy to understand. We have one natural element which is very large, another one which is this here, the green, another one which is that one, and all the others are just sort of objects within this new or redefined area. So this is the area, and this is the services, and this is the main circulation system, that one and that one. And what happens is this area here, because of this division through these circulation systems, is a security area for the bank, so that it can be used even if it's open air, is on the other side of this element which divides the non-security area from this security area. So this, the whole thing becomes one element which you can identify as being part of one single institution. And the buildings we added are very small towers, and they are not one tower, but there are always two towers. And they are, as you see here, they are inclined, so that they do not work just one single, less single object, but they create a tension which is already between them, and between them and the new or the other old buildings, the existing ones. So here you see the geometry of this couple of towers confrontated to that, to the existing buildings, which volumetrically behave like that, so that the context is changed. Wow. And spatially, they create different tension fields between them and the existing buildings. So the whole life within one of these towers is sort of depending of the situation of this being inclined, and the whole structure, I'm not going to explain that in detail now because it's going to take too long. So this is one, just an example, one tower with one of these units there, and from the back. So that you normally, you have one unit which occupies the whole tower in one section. So that the relationship, because of these units, is already defined by the direction of the building, because these units have just one direction, or a main direction, which always focus another situation which is similar or which is the contrary by the existing buildings. So here is probably better see. So on the ground floor, the new buildings, the little ones there, they occupy somehow the whole area. And also spatially, this floor above, they occupy their area as well, the whole space around these six existing buildings. And in the middle is just canteen. So this view all over there. So that the territory here is defined by actually not only the new geometry of this, but also by the tension which is new between them and the existing context.
I think we didn't mention that these the vertical elements you saw on these drawings are the existing buildings, of course.
Make that clear. I don't think it was clear that these are existing pieces, and what we've added are these other things.
Because we wouldn't make a building like that, I hope. So we're flying very briefly. We've finished now. Seeing from very far, this what is golden here is actually a storage building. This was still under construction. Sorry, I have to go back. Something. Sorry for that. Yes, we're flying, and then you see this bridge, which has now kind of spoiled a little bit the condition which we originally found, which was without that bridge. So our buildings are now not really the biggest element in that valley anymore, but they have actually been dwarfed by this stuff. We come closer to this building. You see it's under construction, you see the big wall, how it divides in the valley. We fly around it a little bit. In the back is one of the buildings we haven't discussed, is the storage building in relation to the landscape. We go down from the back and look at the storage building very briefly. So again, it has kind of a very clear shape relating to the landscape or a function, and it has sort of other elements which are more related to the actual kind of local condition. You see the building, this is one of these kind of temporary conditions which will change. This is just a couple of photographs. This is how it looks inside. As you can see, or maybe just about see, that these walls are not vertical also. This has to do with the landscape, their objects in landscape. Also one of these areas which are sort of very temporary, the later things will be added. This is restrooms for the people who work in the storage building. This is a little administration building for them. And then one of the inner courtyards, which is sort of like the industrial zone, which we haven't discussed. The production building would be right there, sort of there. This will be at the end when the project is complete, then the production building would run down here. And some view, which I think in similar way you have seen, showing the front and the back, the park in the front and the back, the industrial things, the car park. And when you are up in the administration building, you overlook the site. This is a lake for fire water. This is the approach to the administration building. This is a canteen, a very small building in front of a large building. The building sits in the park. Inside, the canteen is very much related to this park condition. This is the wall with the bridge. The administration building from the outside, from a very different view, the bridge, perhaps you have seen it. Inside the administration building entrance level, which is now spoiled by something, is a very rough, just like it's also like street lamps actually, so it's not really a kind of a nice designed entrance hall. And then again, the building in the landscape, or from the back as a whole picture. Just one in-between condition, which is sort of accidental or maybe not, is a big storage building relating to the car park. They're kind of interesting, or we think interesting spaces developing, more interesting, in fact, to some extent than the ones that are planned. And then one of these other conditions relating, this is the administration building you have seen, and the storage and sort of temporary surfaces which later will be buildings will be added. And then the last picture is just the materials that sort of constitute the front of this project. Thank you very much.
Questions, but before we move to them, the Braun factory is a wonderful child of the imagination of James Stirling. We're on the scene for Lady Stirling. And yet, as one examines the appearance of the buildings in that block, there isn't, for example, what Corbusier may have done or would have done, did do in the Unité, where the arrangement of the program of the apartments led to facade solutions. So that throughout, while the rhetoric, because in fact, modeling arguments have been so subject to question and analysis for so long that I think they have to now be seen as rhetoric. The rhetoric is on the one hand, and yet the forms are deeply eclectic, and one can see right in the copper building, you can see right in the facade, which is small and indented in the Mayan period of right. You see barons in the end elevation of the administration block, which are last. You're really so clear that it's remarkable. And even Herzog and Dumeron in the facade, the regular building. So I find it very interesting that a building which is proposed in this time, when modernist forms are so me eclectically has no argument or observation about the rhetorical power of that way of doing things.
Because I'm interested in what is abdication of responsibility for me of the work, which is seems to me to be most acute in the Iron Age drawings, which have been cropped up between the projects. And one thing that occurred to me time and time again, seeing the plan, was that it seemed somehow nothing less than the diagram of the high school chemistry set with retorts and pipettes and glass instruments disposed in the landscape. And one thing that came to mind for me was in relation to both that and to the charcoal drawings, which were used as a key device in presenting the two other projects, was a relation to the teaching of not Aldo Rossi himself, but Fabio Reinhardt and Gustav Schick at the ETH Zurich in the previous decade, which was formulated around an idea of an analogous architecture. And I think this actually has a direct relationship to what Tony's just been talking about, but the evocation of a kind of a minefield of
devices and rhetorical figures from early modernism, Behrens, A.E.G., so on and so forth, which has already referred to. And Nervi's fascination with not so much structural rigor as the complication and the expression of structural forces, again, as a rhetorical leads one to suspect that the tectonic arguments and the formal function arguments are a big cover-up. And what we're actually seeing here is a kind of a repressed other side of modernism, which has finally popped up to the surface in the shape of giant chemistry sets, giant sea monsters, dinosaurs, and all sorts of other bits and pieces, which have as much to do with Giacometti's palace at 4 a.m. or Max Ernst's cockroaches like Trafalgar, first gasometric picture by Dada Max Minimax, which is one of my favourites, and I don't know why he can come to mind for this project, but he does. And I wondered whether you'd have something to say about that, because I think it seems to me that both Tony and I are actually attacking. What? We have the responsibility to stand up for the connotations, evocations, and other reminiscences that emerge explicitly and implicitly and expressly all the time.
There you are.
that one was one of the most powerful for me, because I saw not so much structural rigor as an enormous number of saints marching to Calvary, the little hill on which they would be crucified.
Well, I think this will probably go on forever. I mean, this, as I see, these images that arise and people see, like you mentioned, the IAEA building, which seems to kind of strike people as being an analogy to this building, but if you actually, or that's probably intentional or something, I mean, people write things like that. But in fact, it's not. I mean, it's a...
Of course, it has a similar shape, if you want, at first glance, but I think it's more a problem of education. If you actually look at the building, it's structurally, it's architecturally completely different. It has nothing in common with the IEG building. It has some similar strategies like columns going from the outside to the inside through roof and things like that, but it's not the only building that does that. So it's more like, I think it has to do with this sort of education, architectural understanding of architecture as images. I mean, there were people writing about the administration building being like the Roman, was a female wolf, what's that in English? Sort of having this kind of breasts of this thing feeding the computer. I mean, for us, that's just monumental nonsense. And it just doesn't say, I mean, of course, anything that has a kind of expression, I think, kind of... produces images in people, and of course, because of modern architecture, of course, if you see a thing that's raised above the ground or so, you think of a piloti. But I don't think, or at least for us, I don't know, Renzo may have a different view of that, but I don't think we've ever even discussed these images. The first time when we sort of shortly before it opened, actually, someone said that he thought it looked like the IEG building. It never occurred to me. I think it's completely out of, you know, it's like a matrix put one thing on top of the other, which have nothing to do, you know, nothing in common. It's like two worlds. And so for us, that's not a problem. We never thought like that. I mean, we're trying to do things in a kind of straight way. Of course, the strategies may be similar to modernist strategies, but they're not... we're not creating images, or we're not relating to images, and I don't feel responsible for the mistakes people, or these misreadings of this building. I mean, it's a good case. I mean, there's been a tremendous amount of stuff been written on these buildings, and there's very little, actually. If you look at it, or we thought, at least what we showed tonight was a sort of more kind of an analytical understanding of these buildings. And if you look at it that way, then it's quite different. Then the cone suddenly is not a kind of a capital of a column, but the cone becomes something completely different, as Renzo explained. So I think it's a sort of this lack of actually I'm not trying to be aggressive, but there's a lack of a kind of thorough understanding of architectural elements, which leads to this kind of image production.
Lack of understanding of 30 years' argument, which has been in the public realm, which shows that modernism, when it adopted this policy that somehow forms were innocent and entirely derivative from functional considerations, has been completely demolished. And to iterate it now in this way and claim again it's the innocence of the modernists is, it's wrong of you, I suggest, to say that the criticism here is undereducated. I mean, I think your approach.
No, I think it's over-educated, actually. I mean, you know.
No, I don't think you've done that, because that's another strategy, which is to say that you reserve to yourself the kind of innocence of modernism. It simply, it never existed. It was illusionistic when it was proposed. I mean, even someone, for instance, in your triangular buildings, you proposed an argument that the building itself was simply made by the bare facts of its making. And that's a very similar position to, say, Hans Meyer. And yet Hans Meyer's buildings are expressive of a whole series of ideas. And to dismiss that as you're doing, and to say that it's too academic, is to deny yourself the possibility of understanding architecture as a cultural product. And if you adopt this innocent position, an innocent modernist position, you'll always be making forms which you don't really understand, because you cut yourself off from the whole price of buildings being understood.
But what difference does it make? I mean, I wonder what difference does it make? I mean, if some people have made certain shapes, or have built certain buildings and with certain kind of, have used certain strategies, and then we kind of reuse them, but we're not. I don't understand. We never look at these things as being sort of. Of course, we know that there's a history of architecture. I mean, we're sort of aware of that, but we never think now we're doing something that Corbusier did at that point, or what we're trying to do is we just want someone to go there, like this triangular building. I mean, it's not going to be built, but we wanted someone to just go there and understand why the plan is as funny as it is, because it's a triangular building, and then. That he understands that the building is, this person understands that the building develops from this particular situation. It could not be anywhere else. It cannot be repeated. It should just be there and nowhere else. It's not a strategy for kind of it's not a political sort of strategy. It's just for that particular point.
It's interesting that your strategies are in a way hermetic. They are the layouts that you show in the disposition diagrams, including drawings of very similar to Stirling's propositions that architecture was an internalized practice which didn't really have to refer to the rest of the world, but its understanding is very internal. It's very unsustainable. I mean, I think what's interesting is that your position is classic modernism. I mean, it's not, there's no deviation from classic modernism, as far as I can see. Nothing you've said is. Yet, even in classic modernism, somebody like Corbusier understood, deeply understood, that the forms that he was making weren't actually products, they weren't instruments, that they did have a referential quality. That's why he wrote verse in architecture and showed pictures of those. You know, he understood that. He didn't understand it too well, and other people came after it and understood it in a more sophisticated way, but he seemed to be. I honestly don't think you can reject these arguments in the way that you are.
Well, let's see if we can broaden the argument a bit. Let's take it beyond that. You've made a very strong case, don't you? Maybe we can broaden the argument.
Well, how do you reconcile the perversity of unstable structures? I mean, one of the things about the mill building that you show is its lack of logistic potential, that it solves the problem very directly. But I remember in the office in 1988, you made statements that were quite perverse statements about how the columns of the walkway should seem to be falling down for aesthetic reasons, or how the cones should have the appearance of hanging, not supporting, but actually hanging, for what sounded like purely aesthetic reasons. How do you reconcile these rather perverse kinds of intentions with the structural approach, which may allow a certain latitude of different structural solutions, but tries to make a direct confrontation of a building with its tectonic forces? Don't you contradict, isn't your approach, or the way you explain your approach, self-contradictory?
That's the point.
It's not aesthetic, these propositions like the bridge structure. It's we're trying to show that a structure, of course, a structure, the main reason or the main, of course, the main purpose of structure is to actually hold up a building, but it can also be something more. It can actually show what a building does in a certain position in a landscape or within other in relation to other buildings. So it's not an aesthetic proposal to have the building fall towards the wall, this timber building falling towards the wall, but it's the idea of showing through the kind of visual, purely visual understanding of the kind of forces of this building, understand that there is a very close relationship between those two buildings, which actually a functional relationship, which is that the one thing cannot work with, it does not make sense without the other. So it's like, and this kind of increasing instability of this building is like kind of showing that there is an increasing relationship between the two buildings, because at the end of the building, or this timber building, you're actually forced to leave it, or because it ends. So you're actually at the point where the relationship between the two things is the strongest. That's where also the structural relationship is the strongest, because most forces, or the quantitatively actually, the most amount of structural force actually goes into that wall at that point where you have to leave it. So it has a sort of, I don't think it's aesthetic, or of course it has a kind of an aesthetic effect. But
even that explanation gives a certain expressive
I think it goes beyond that. Of course, that's kind of the most simple. We didn't show these kind of storage buildings, for example, which are very much like this mill ring. That does nothing. I mean, it's just purely structure, no intentions whatsoever. But these buildings we showed are obviously the ones that are most complex and most kind of spectacular. And that was, I don't think it's a rule, if you want. You could not repeat it. I mean, I'm sure someone will copy these kind of bridges. I'm sure, but it will not be, it's like, it's in that particular point you can do that, but I don't think you should do it anywhere else. So it's like that's it, you know, finished, other problem.
Doesn't that imply that one building is designed with one process, which is very straightforward, and other buildings require a kind of aesthetic help which is the more elaborate building? It sounds like two approaches.
No, one is itself. I would say it's on a different level. I mean, it's in a higher degree of complexity. That's all. I mean, it's just you play with the structure in a kind of more sophisticated way, for some reason, for maybe trying to relate a building to a landscape, like the administration building is only related through the structure, basically, to landscape, things like that. It's just more sophisticated. It's not really. It's not different, essentially.
Thank you.